This past year, the radical left with their globalist mindset has burned down our cities, forced businesses to close, and tried to silence our churches. They told us to wear a mask and stay home to save lives, and many Christians remained silent. That is no longer an option. The silent majority will be silent no more, and the sleeping giant has been awakened. We are going to use our voice to take back the media, stop the censorship, and very loudly take back the public square. I'm Tim Thompson, and this is Our Watch.
Well, good evening, everybody. Good to see you all here, and I want to say hello to everybody that is tuned in online. Welcome to Our Watch. Glad you are with us. Really excited about our guest tonight because we're going to be talking about some things that are very, very relevant. They're very, very real in what's going on in our culture, and I think it's of the utmost importance that we have facts and we hear from professionals. And tonight is certainly no exception to that. We've got some great facts and a great professional to talk to us. Before we get into that, I just want to share a quick video that goes along with a story that the Washington Post did, and it kind of shows us a little bit about what we have going on tonight. So take a look.
I wanted to let him know that things get a lot better, but I didn't have the chance to tell him about that.
Hello!
Tantan was one of the brightest people you would have ever met. He was just one of those people that loved to make you laugh. I don't want to say that COVID had nothing to do with my brother's death because I truly wouldn't ever know. I do think that the isolation and anxiety of being alone with quarantining may have exacerbated his symptoms. I think that he was depressed. He was 15 years old and he took his life on August 30th, 2020.
So according to this article that just came out this week by the Washington Post, it says parents can make a plan to decrease suicide risk in their teens. Here's how. And so in this article, it says that 3 months into the pandemic, my brother in Brooklyn found her daughter, Anna, throwing up in the middle of the night. Worried it was COVID, she rushed the 11-year-old to the hospital where the doctors were ready to send her home. But Anna's mom told them that she wasn't leaving until they figured out what was wrong. It says, eventually a doctor tested Anna's blood for toxins. She had been intentionally overdosing on the over-the-counter medication for 3 days. Had she not vomited, she would have died. And so there is a very real thing going on right now with mental health across the board. And I think it's important for us to know what's going on. And in order to do that, we want to make sure we hear from licensed professionals that we trust. One of those people is here with us tonight. Our guest this evening is a licensed psychologist with over 25 years in practice. She's a graduate of the University of Southern California, and there she had studied under renowned trauma expert Dr. John, I don't know if I'm saying this right, but Breyer, she can correct me when she comes out, and distinguished substance abuse researcher Dr. Michael Newcomb. Please welcome our guest tonight, Dr. Shannae Anderson. Hello.
Hello.
Thank you for coming out.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, of course. You know, we've got a mutual friend, Pastor Rob McCoy.
Yes, we do.
And you go to his church. We've met mm-hmm. there when we came out. Some of you may have went with us. We went out there when Pastor Rob's church was being threatened with all the fines and stuff like that. And you know, Pastor Rob, basically, what he did was when that first happened, I don't know if you know this, but when that first happened, he called me right away. He goes, okay, Tim, so I might get arrested. So here's what I need. I need you to be there, and I'm going to preach the gospel, and if I get arrested, I need you to walk up to the pulpit and just keep on preaching.
I didn't know that.
I said, I'll be there. So thankfully, he didn't get arrested, but you know, he went through the ringer, and many of you did. You guys stood by Pastor Rob McCoy, and he's continued to really stand strong and be a leader in our community, and so it's a great great pastor that you have, and we just love that guy. But we're grateful to have you out tonight. This is a real topic. This is a real concern. And in many ways, it's a thing that's not being addressed. It's definitely not a hot topic with the mainstream media.
Right.
Not hearing about this at all. But this is an important thing. And you have really, I mean, I've listened to several of your talks, and you really have a grasp of what's going on. So maybe if you would, just as we open up, just address the kind of the big picture, and then maybe we'll get into some of the details.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, I want to thank you so much for having me on, because I have been speaking about the mental health effects of the lockdown since I was on the Fireside Chat with Pastor Rob, starting back in April, so almost for a full year. And while there have been other churches and a few other organizations that are interested in hearing what I have to say, the secular world really doesn't want to have to see this. Most individuals are not talking about it. I've even spoken at secular things, and the media doesn't ever want to talk with me because I'm speaking things that nobody wants to hear, that the lockdowns that that we have been under for the past year have devastated every segment of our population, everything from the elderly to, you know, married people with children are having difficulties, but most in particular is our youth, and particularly the teenagers. I was listening to the video before we started. The mental health consequences of being in isolation and being so locked down is catastrophic, and we're only beginning to see the consequences of this. And I know we're hoping that the lockdown is gonna be slowly lifted, especially in California. But people don't recognize that doesn't mean that everybody is now feeling better. We are going to be seeing long-term consequences of this lockdown for decades and generations to come.
Yeah, and you had made mention not just the youth, but even the very, very young children, because of you know, things that happen when you're young. Can you kind of explain that for the audience?
Sure. When we're all born, God creates us as babies for a reason, I believe. We're not born as adults like Adam and Eve were, but he has us born as very helpless, dependent children that are required to attach to a primary caregiver, which is usually the mother figure. And through repeated interactions between mother and child, the child's developing brain kind of comes online. When we're born with genetic predispositions. We will be born with certain temperaments. For anybody who's a parent, you know, two children are not
the
same.
No two kids are alike.
Even from the womb.
Yeah.
That's temperament, but actually interactions with parents in particular create the structure and function of the brain. And what is so critical for this to happen is the face-to-face contact between a mother and her infant, for the mother to be able to gaze into the child's eyes, for the child to see the mother bask in the child's and have joy on her face. And now we're seeing parents, even of infants, masked so that these children are unable to see the full face of their parent. And I believe we are going to be seeing just devastating consequences from this, because there are certain brain structures that are not going to be fully formed, neural pathways that are not going to be formed. We were sharing that there are certain emotions that are hidden when you're wearing a mask, such as joy.
Right.
But the emotions that are seen when you have a mask on are actually only fear and anger. And so all of these children are being raised in a culture of only seeing fear and anger, and having parents also that are terrified either of getting the virus or of, you know, killing somebody else who's maybe at higher risk, these children are becoming anxious themselves and not able to have their brains form in a way where they're going to be able to self-soothe later in life.
Right. And so we've got that going on. We also have people walking around in fear. You have a quote here by Paul Slavik, PhD, mm-hmm. if we could throw that up. I'll turn it over. You go.
Do you want
and
me to
share
read it?
Go ahead. Yeah, share this.
Our sense of risk is driven by our emotions. We judge risk by our feelings more than looking at data and statistics and evidence. And I think that that is so important to understand because it explains what's really going on. I always teach the brain in the palm of the hand. Is it okay if I do that a little bit here to explain?
Sure.
I'm going to teach you guys how to understand how fear actually works in your brain. So you can understand why everybody has lost their minds during this time and nobody is actually thinking logically. So if you guys can go with me, if you put your hand up like this and you put your thumb over and you close it in the front, this is your brain. Your eyes are in the front. Your head is at the top. This is the back of your brain. This is your spinal cord. The lowest part of your brain is your brain stem, and that is responsible for your heart rate, temperature, breathing. If they say you're brain dead, that part of your brain is gone. That regulates your body. The highest part of your brain is called the neocortex, and that's the thinking part of the brain, and that's the part that develops when you're about 2, 3, 4 and on throughout the rest of your life. This is the key part. The middle part of your brain, if you kind of lift off that neocortex, in the middle is what we call the limbic system, and where your thumb is touching the center of your palm, that is the amygdala. The amygdala is the fear center of the brain, and it's literally in the middle of the brain, and it is connected to the lower part of the brain, which regulates the body. So when you're afraid, the amygdala gets activated, and it immediately hits the lower part of the brain, which then down-regulates the body. Ideally, when we're scared, we want to be able to use our higher brain function, which I always see it as kind of sounds silly, as giving your amygdala a big hug. And when we're operating here, you actually are thinking clearly and you're able to be logical. But what you have to understand is when we get scared, literally that part of our brain shuts off. And we are operating from purely the limbic system and pure emotion. And we don't have the capacity to actually think and address things logically. And I think that has happened from the very beginning of the lockdown with the media and all the fear porn of showing people dropping dead in China and this virus is going to kill millions. And people were so terrified and locked in their homes that we were all operating out of this. I know I was. I was afraid. I think we all were afraid. But what's happened is when you stay in this state of mind, and a way to stay in this state of mind, in this fear state of mind, is to not be around other people, to not get a reality check, to not do things that are going to actually start using your higher brain function. So I believe for the past year, many people are just walking around in a chronic state of fear, which then has a whole bunch of other consequences. You're not thinking clearly, but it also is going to affect your body and your immune system. It's going to decrease your immunity because you're in a constant fight or flight state of mind, which is then going to put you at greater risk for getting sick. Also, social isolation is another thing that is going to impact your immunity and keep you from staying healthy. And so it's like we've got this, the worst possible case scenario. Let's lock everybody away so we're not talking to each other. We have no social support. We're throwing fear at you constantly, and it's unfortunately led to some horrible things that we're seeing in our country now.
Yeah, well, you have a slide that shows COVID-19 deaths on the top, the surface, and the whole idea. Well, there it is, the whole iceberg thing, and we all get the concept. When you see an iceberg, you're only seeing a small portion of
it.
Most of it's under the water.
Right.
And everybody's talking COVID, all these deaths. Well, is that the main thing? Is that all of it? I think there's a whole lot more to it.
Well, and that's where I've been complaining, you know, the cure can't be worse than the disease. And I think that's what we're seeing. And I have a whole bunch of statistics. I don't know if you want me to go into them, but I'm just even thinking one statistics is in Japan, in the entire country of Japan, there have been more suicides than COVID deaths. There have been more deaths of overdoses and suicides in some parts, some cities throughout the country than COVID deaths. We know that the death rate for our young adults from 18 to 24 has increased in 2020 by about 25%. But if you really look at the data, that percentage of the population, they're not dying from COVID. So what are they dying from? And what is tragic is they've been hiding suicide numbers. And they're saying they're not going to get stuff out for at least 2022. Yeah.
Right.
And there's a lot of stuff that's not coming out. But I was able to even predict a lot of this. If you look back at other previous pandemics and temporary quarantines and lockdowns, you can see devastating effects. And so the fact that this has already been going on for over a year, this is a horrible first-time social experiment that I don't think you could ever get approval from a research board to do, because it is just killing people.
Yeah. So you've got some statistics here. One of them has to do with serious mental distress and then moderate mental distress, both of those being up. Serious mental distress up 8 times. Moderate mental distress up 3 times. Those are alarming numbers.
Well, this was actually, and I don't know if you want to put up the slide, this was the very first research study that came out in May, and they were able to put it out. It wasn't peer-reviewed yet, but it's been peer-reviewed, and it's now been published. They looked at adults in March and April of 2020, and they compared them, very similar sample, to adults from 2018. And what they found is that serious mental distress went up 8 times. So it went from 3.4% of the entire population to 27.7%. So think about that. That's over a quarter of our population suffering from serious mental distress. But this is even better. They then measured moderate mental distress, and there was a 3 times increase, that it went from 22% of the population suffering with moderate mental distress because of the lockdown to 70.4. That is almost 3/4 of our population in March and April alone that were endorsing significant anxiety and depression and distress. And what I've seen in my practice, and some of the data is beginning to show, the longer that this goes on, the more it's increasing in the severity, that more and more people are struggling, and their struggling is actually getting worse. In fact, one of the worst populations that's having a hard time, there are two populations in particular that are really having a difficult time, those that have pre-existing conditions, so people that already were suffering with mental illness, that already had anxiety disorders and depressive disorders, their rates of increase have gone through the roof. But also, and this is my area of specialty, I specialize in trauma, and individuals that have a history of childhood trauma, whether that's being abuse, neglect, abandonment, they're at the greatest risk for having psychological damage from this lockdown. Some of the belief it is because of what I was talking about earlier, that if you do not have a secure attachment with your primary caregiver and you're being abused by that individual, it puts you already at risk for these,
right,
these anxiety and depressive and trauma-based disorders, and this lockdown has just exacerbated it all.
Yeah, so these numbers you're sharing with me, just they're alarming. I do the news every day. I report the news, and one of the things that's talked about quite a bit is these suicide numbers. And there's a lot of people trying to say, "Oh, well, suicides aren't up. They're not up." Well, how can anybody say that if the numbers haven't come out? Are you hearing anything though about numbers?
I'm not hearing anything about numbers, but I can tell you, I have never had so many family members who have had family members kill themselves in my practice as I do right now. I am hearing story after story after story of, in particular, young people killing themselves. We're seeing a lot of this. I have a colleague who's a psychologist in Texas, and they're as young as 10 years old. They're in elementary school killing themselves because children and teenagers in particular are not meant to be alone. We're not meant to be alone.
No.
I mean, God created us to be in community. And yet teenagers in particular need to psychologically separate away from their parents and connect to teenagers, and that's how they begin to find their identity. And the fact that they can't do this, I have one teenager in particular who I've been seeing since the lockdown, and her parents are so afraid, she literally has not left her house other than to see me, by the grace of God. Again, they're allowing her to do that. She's masked up and very far away. But she's cutting. She's engaging in an eating disorder. She's drinking. She's using drugs. She's having sex. She's suicidal. None of this was present before the lockdown.
Wow. It saddens me to hear these kind of figures. One of the things that I think we could have predicted, you take a lot of people who are going to make more money being on unemployment, let them stay home, give them that extra money, and then just tell them that, you know, don't go and be around anybody. Just be at home. We're going to see drug abuse on the rise. We're going to see alcoholism on the rise. Some of these figures you have down here about alcohol sales up 54%, and then the online alcohol sales up 262%.
Right.
This is the figures you're putting out. I mean, this is...
And that was just the first week of the lockdown.
Oh, okay.
Just the first week.
Oh, I wonder where we're at now.
Exactly.
Oh, my gosh.
Try to find the data. And that's the thing is, as a psychologist and researcher, I have, my husband can attest this, I have a giant file box filled with articles. I'm constantly looking for this data every single day. And a lot of it is not out there because nobody's talking about it. They don't understand the problem we're facing.
Right. Yeah, well, I think, and then also I think there's an element of this where they don't want us to know these figures.
Right.
You know, and kind of the whole ignorance is bliss type of thing. But I think it's interesting what you're saying about how our brains were developed or how they developed, how God created us. One of the things that's continued to ring true for me as I've studied God's Word, I've been studying this book for a long time, and I talk to people like you that are way smarter than me when it comes to the to the human body. And it's funny because everything God says in here, there's this thought as believers sometimes, like, well, gosh, you know, I read through the Bible, and it seems like a big book of can-dos and shouldn't-dos. And you think, well, God, at some point, some people think, well, God just doesn't want me to have any fun. You know, and the fact is, the things God tells us to do are very, very good. They're very healthy for us. And the things he tells us to abstain from, if we don't abstain from it, we're going to be very unhealthy. And we think about, you know, Romans chapter 12, that we're not to be conformed to the world, but we're to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. It wasn't until I talked to a doctor like yourself that I realized you can actually renew your mind. That, you know, these neurons that we have, one doctor, a doctor named Dr. Doan that I talked to years ago, he said, Tim, and this is just my pastor brain speaking here, but he says, neurons, whatever neurons fire together, wire together.
Yes, Hebb's Law. Very good.
Okay, I remember that. But but I remember him saying, you know, you create a pathway, the pathway is there. And this is why when people get addicted to substances, you know, the neurons fire together, they wire together, then they want more of that. And so there's this increasing desire for that, and that, because that pathway's there. And then when you think, okay, well, if I'm going to renew my mind, I start taking the Bible in, and I start letting other neurons fire together. And he talked about some that are dominant neurons and some that are not. He says, what happens is the more you do what God tells you, the more those neurons are firing together, and that the more you want that. And so there really is a renewing of your mind. But I think what we're seeing right now is the exact opposite of that.
Right.
Everything that they're telling us to do is not good for our minds. And if it's not good for our minds, it ends up not being good for our bodies. And it's all connected. God made us body, soul, and mind. You know, so these things are connected, and we're going to see a whole lot of unhealthy people.
Well, and we are. And it's so interesting you're saying that, because I remember at the very beginning of the lockdown speaking with Pastor Rob and talking about what I was seeing initially in my private practice. All of our idols got removed. I don't know if any of you guys experienced that, but initially, think about it. All of our idols, we couldn't go to the movies, we couldn't go to concerts, we couldn't go out to bars, we couldn't hang out with our friends. A lot of the things that I think we put a lot of our interest and time and value in, we couldn't engage in anymore. And so I do think initially a lot of people really plummeted because they didn't know what to do. And so fortunately, I have a lot of believers in my practice, so I'm able to say, now is the time to renew your mind and dive into God's word. And really, this is a great opportunity. And those who tend to be resilient have actually flourished. What I think is great, there's some great statistics out there. There is one group of people thriving in this lockdown, and it's those that attend church every week.
Yes.
Yes, amen. There is a ton of research that talks about how going to church benefits your mental health, your physical health. We know what it does to us spiritually. There is a 6 times lower risk of suicide if you are going to church every week. And so that, I think, the fact that you've been open, the fact that Pastor Rob has been open, is saving lives, literally.
Yeah.
Literally.
Another mutual friend we have, Pastor Mike McClure, over $3 million in fines at this point.
Ridiculous.
It's just insane. This is a man who's been arguing everything you just said. He's arguing it in the courts. We have to do this. This is healthy for people. And I went up there for a news conference, and I was talking. Well, first I went out and I said what I had to say. And really, I just was there to
no, I saw you.
I was just there to chastise the pastors for closing their churches and tell them they need to open. But there was this group of old ladies that were there, and they were the sweetest old ladies, and they were in their 90s. These were old women, 90s. They were so happy to have found Calvary Chapel San Jose, so happy to have found a place they can walk into and not have to wear a mask and be able to because even their grandkids didn't want to see them.
Wow.
Nobody wanted to see them. And so they found a place where they could show up and live their life in dignity. And it was a beautiful thing to hear them, because they were like basically telling everybody else, you need to just come to this church. And we've experienced that here at the church that I pastor, 412 Church. We've had people walk in the doors and then they start crying. And I don't even have to ask them what's wrong. I already know what it is. Because it's tears of joy.
Right.
It's not anything else. They walk in and it's like, I'm in a place where I don't have to cover my face.
Right.
And I don't have to be afraid somebody's going to yell at me, put that mask on.
Well, and
you
there's
know.
Connection.
Right, and there's that physical,
there's that
human connection. Yeah, God created us to have that. God says in the Word, we don't do this here, but He says, greet one another with a holy kiss. We don't do it because culturally that's not our thing.
Right.
But culturally, what do we do in America? We hug.
Right.
We shake hands, we hug. You know, and now it's weird. Like, you see some people go shake their hand, they're like,
right.
But, well, I don't know what to do. Like, well, I'll tell you what, just come here and give me a hug. You know, that's what I do. Like, just give me a, we'll just hug.
There
you
is
know?
A great study, and it's my favorite study when I talk to people about this, that hugs actually boost immunity. There is a research study where they actually gave people live viruses. One was a cold virus, one was a flu virus. And then they made sure that they had the live virus in them, and then they locked them away in a hotel room for 2 weeks. And then they measured the severity of their symptoms. And what was amazing is that those that received at least one hug a day, despite getting the virus injected into them, most of them did not even test positive for the virus. So it was in them, but they didn't even test positive. Those that did test positive had fewer symptoms. So the fact that we are having to be 6 feet apart, we can't hug, we can't communicate, we have to be isolated, all of these are things that are depleting our immune system and then adding to it all the psychological damage.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, that's the thing. We've been open. I've had it, my wife's had it, my son's had it, my daughter's had it. Pretty much everybody I've been around has had it. And I don't know how many in the audience here have had it, but I know a lot of people have had it. And the ones that I know that have had it, like, we're all around each other. We all hug each other. We all say hello. We all are like, hey, we got through this. No big deal, you know? And everybody I talk to that I know is in that type of fellowship, you make a good point. Everybody I know, they're like, yeah, we got through this.
Yeah. My 84-year-old father got it, and he's fine.
Yeah. Fine. Lots of hugs.
Lots of hugs.
Yeah.
He's a hugger.
Well, good. I want to share a Bible verse real quick. Acts chapter 17. And many of you may have heard this verse. There, Paul stands in the midst of the Areopagus, and he talks to me. He says, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. For as I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription. It says, 'To the unknown God.' And therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, him I proclaim to you." And I love this verse because what you're seeing is Paul talked to a group of people who believe themselves to be very religious. And they have, and really when you look at that culture, it was the Greek culture. They were, you know, they were very steeped in human philosophy. And then he goes on to explain and proclaim this God that they were worshiping supposedly without knowing. And this is what he says. He says, God, in verse 24 and 20 through 26, says, God who made the world and everything in it, since he is the Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives all, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. So he goes on to say, okay, he's the God that's created everything. He's the God that gives and sustains life. And he's the God who has set all the boundaries of every nation on earth. And so what he's doing is he's starting with God and working his way down to man, where all these other people had started with man and worked their way up to God, which is why if you look at the Greek gods, many of the Greek gods, I mean, all of them were false gods, but all of them were like men. They were angry, jealous, lustful, you know, they were at war with one another. I mean, it's just bad because they took the philosophy of man and worked their way up. So the reason I'm bringing this out is I'm watching what's taking place right now all over our culture, and there is a continual rejection of God, rejection that he is the one who created everything, rejection of him being the one that sustains life. And we know this, that the government does not have the answer to the very important question of what happens after you die? Life after death, what is it? How do you get there? What's it going to be like? They don't have the answer. And so what they have is a whole lot of people focused on the here and the now. And when they get them focused on the here and the now and afraid of what might happen afterwards, they're going to walk around in fear, like you said. And if they're going to walk around in fear, that's going to drive their decision-making. And I want to get back to that because we know, and we talked about this over dinner tonight, and you and your husband, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, we understand that at some point there's going to be supernatural work of delusion upon people. People are going to be delusional. And I'm wondering, because we don't know how God works out his prophetic dealings with people, but I wonder if this is a part of it, because there is this driving fear that's driving everybody. And I'm like, how do you not see this?
Right.
Pure statistics. Why can't you see these things?
Right. No, I talk to my friends about that all the time, and it starts to make you feel kind of crazy at times, because it's like, why am I seeing something that you're not seeing?
Yeah, am I the one that's crazy?
Am I the one that's crazy?
Right.
And that's part of, I think, the gaslighting that we're all subject to by the media in particular. But I do think God is doing something. I think there definitely is something supernatural going on, especially because of the number of believers that are not getting this. And that are living in fear. And we are not to live in fear. God did not give us a power or a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. We're supposed to have a sound mind, not live purely from emotion. Right. And that's what's happening. And I think it is feeding, is going to instill, is feeding a lot of destruction.
Yeah, you said something key right there, I think, not living from emotion. I've been watching over the last several decades, I've been preaching about this just recently, there is a push for a person to live solely off their feelings.
Right.
And I said there's three things that drive everything that we do. Our faith, our feelings, and our knowledge. Mm-hmm. And really, our faith is good and we need it, but we don't have much. Jesus even told his disciples, "Oh, you of little faith."
Right.
You know, so we don't have much, we need it, but we don't have much. And feelings can be very misleading. So that leaves knowledge. And I paint it really clear when I say this. There's times you feel like God's not there, mm-hmm. but you got to go with what you know. He said,
right.
"I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake
right.
you." So he's always going to be there. So that feeling's misleading. And I'm sure, and I said this, and this is not a slight against you at all, but a lot of psychologists ask you a very important question, and that is, how does that make you feel?
That?
How do you feel about that? And there's a lot of emphasis on feelings. And so as a Christian psychologist, mm-hmm. how do you reconcile that?
That is so funny you bring this up, because my patients will know that the one consistent thing that I tell them all the time, feelings are not facts. Feelings are not facts. Yes, you may feel that way, but remember, when we're feeling, we're not thinking. And so I'm always working with them on, yes, feelings are important, especially because I'm a trauma therapist. And so I'm dealing with people who've been horribly sexually abused, physically abused, you know, I've told you I work with survivors from mass shootings. You know, the feelings are horrific, but we can't always act off of our feelings because that gets us in trouble. And so it's really learning how to discern, okay, you have your feelings, but what are you thinking, and trying to bridge the two together and helping people get kind of go up more of what are they thinking, and pulling thoughts and feelings together. Because I'm the first to admit that my field of psychology, I think, has been part of this process of decimating our society. Because what do we have now? Everybody's concerned about feelings. Everybody is a victim. It's all about me. And it's a byproduct, I do believe, of my field. And so, again, by the grace of God, he led me into this, I think, to be able to speak his word and his truth into this. And I do know I'll have, all my patients are like, "You're very different from any other therapist I've ever had." Because I really don't want to, I don't want to feed a lot of the delusions that are out there that are driven by emotion.
Yeah. Yeah. It's been an emphasis. I've watched it.
Yeah.
To the point now where we've almost idolized feelings.
Oh, almost? Absolutely
The feelings are, you know, it's what they're worshiping.
Right.
And to the point where it's like, well, you're not allowed to hurt anybody's feelings.
Right.
Don't hurt their feelings. And if you hurt their feelings, you're somehow engaged in hate speech
right.
or an act of hate because you hurt somebody's feelings.
But one of the big things that's missing are boundaries. That you have your feelings, I have my feelings. We used to live in a country where we had free speech, and we each are allowed to have our own thoughts. We're allowed to have our own feelings. We're allowed to have our own opinions. And back in the day, we used to have boundaries where it was like, okay, that's what you think. That's how you feel. This is what I think, and this is what I feel. And if you don't like it, you learn how to manage those emotions. And that's where I think it goes back to my hand model, mm-hmm. is that people are operating purely from emotion, and nobody is thinking, and a lot of parents are not working with their children to teach them how to regulate and soothe those feelings to get out of their feelings. It's more of, oh, well, gosh, that's how you feel. Well, there you go. That's how you feel. And there's no truth in feelings, because how you feel one moment is going to change in a minute. There
right.
is no truth in feelings.
So let me ask you this then. We got a lot of people here who, they go to church on Sundays. They're healthy. And they're awake. I use that term a lot. They're awake.
Yes.
They know, they see. Their eyes are open. They see spiritually. You guys know, or you wouldn't be here tonight. And our online audience as well, they know. They're awake to what's happening. What do we do? How does a person who's operating like this deal with somebody who's operating like that?
That's a really good question. Because I think when you're talking to somebody who's driven by emotion, they don't want to hear logic. And so what I do is...
I'm sorry, but you're 100% correct. Have you guys noticed that? You're dealing with somebody
they don't want to hear
they're
it.
Like this, and you try to give them logic. You're like, try to give them this. They're like, ah. They don't want to hear the logic. Let me show you the facts. Oh, don't confuse me with your facts.
Right.
I'm sorry, but that was just
but
funny.
But it's true. And yeah. so as a psychologist, as a therapist, the kind of little strategy that I will use is I will validate their emotional experience. I'll say, wow, okay, so you are feeling such and such. And I understand that. And I think being able to understand where people are coming from is a way, and this is where for children, the way children learn self-regulation, which is self-soothing, is you have a child that operates from here because they don't have higher brain functioning. Hopefully they have a mother that's operating from here. And that when the mother sees the child here, the child, in a sense, kind of borrows mom's, it's really the prefrontal cortex, and then that soothes because the mother attunes to the child. The mother will say, okay, yes, I really know that you want to have the cookie before dinner. I understand, I know, but we're not going to have it. And so it's being able to, I think, validate and empathize where people are emotionally because that will calm them down. Because if you come straight at them with logic, you're just going to get into a fight. So
I've experienced that.
It's not going to work. And so if they're here and you're coming at them here, it doesn't work. But if you can try to attune to where they're coming from emotionally and just say, okay, so I understand that you're really scared of this virus and that this must have been terrible. And I see that you're wearing 3 masks and a face shield and a gown and gloves, and you must be really scared. You don't laugh, but and for them to just go, yes, yes, I am. Say, I understand. May I share why I am not scared? And because we've had that emotional connection, it softens their defenses enough that it's a way to get in.
Yeah, maybe that's what I've been doing wrong for the last whole year. I go straight at them like this.
Well, yeah. but you know what I think happens is that we're so frustrated that we're now here. We're like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
And so we end up fighting like kids because none of this is rational. And so if we're like this because everybody's illogical, what we need to do is take a deep breath. Because when we're afraid, our body goes into fight, flight, freeze. And we're either gonna freeze and do nothing, or we're gonna run away and put on all of our masks and hide, or we're gonna fight. And I think if we can soothe ourselves, take some deep breaths, it stops that kind of fight or flight, it triggers the parasympathetic nervous system to calm down the sympathetic nervous system. It calms us down. And then we can speak more rationally. And I think also when people see us being able to be more rational, but at the same time able to kind of flex between the two, because that's the key. We don't want to just operate here and like kind of deck someone because they're not going to get it.
No, we shouldn't operate there and deck. Not that we don't want to.
Exactly, exactly. But that's where I think the empathy is being able to go heart to heart.
Yeah.
And say, even though in your mind you're like, this doesn't make any sense to me, it's really trying to put yourself in their shoes because for some reason they are afraid. And being able to say, help me understand, why are you so scared?
Yeah, right. Yeah, absolutely. I think we have to have that empathy for them. I'm not walking around in fear. You guys aren't walking around in fear. And so how horrible would it be to be walking around in fear like that? You know, I've seen people with the gowns and the gloves and the mask and the, you know, 3 masks with the facial. I've seen that. I'm like, how horrible would that be to walk around with that kind of fear? And when you look at the actual absolute root of this is the fact that we have the Spirit of God in us.
Amen.
God has not given us the spirit of fear. That's what it is.
Yes.
It really comes down to it. I've been watching God's prophetic timelines. I've been watching what he's doing. One of the things he said is he will separate out true believers from false believers, the wheat from the tares. And that's what I think we're seeing that play out in front of us. We're watching the true, because the true believers are not walking around in fear.
Yeah.
And, you know, the fact is there's going to be, you know, a lot of wheat and tares growing up together, and outwardly they look the role, and there's going to be a lot of people who thought, well, I thought they were a believer, but are they? I don't know. I mean, they're not walking in the Spirit of God, because you walk in the Spirit of God, you're not walking in the spirit of fear, because that's not from God. We only have a few minutes left, and I want to ask you one final question and kind of get back to the children, because we've got parents, we've got grandparents. This is a real risk right now. There's a lot of kids that have a lot of things speaking into their lives, not just parents, not just grandparents. They are inundated with voices, whether it be through social media, the TV, whatever. There are teachers. There's all sorts of things going on. What are the warning signs that parents and grandparents should look for? A lot of the reports I'm hearing are, we never knew, we didn't know. We didn't know that he or she felt that way. We didn't know he was going to try to kill himself. It just caught us by surprise. And I understand that many times it will, but if we could know what warning signs to look for, what questions to ask, maybe we can help catch these things before they get to that point.
The first thing I always recommend is, first of all, for parents to remove their own blinders. I think parents sometimes don't see things because they don't want to see things. Either it's because it reminds them of things they've walked through themselves and they've never dealt with, or things that they don't want to deal with, or, oh my gosh, it's going to make me look like a bad parent. And so the first thing that I really recommend that parents do is, you know, check out where you're at and have your own support system and talk to people of what is going on out there. What do I need to be prepared for? Okay, so kids are drinking. Really? They're starting to drink at like 8 years old. Really? And they're having sex at 10. Really? I mean, it's about realizing some of these things are very real out there. And so once you're aware and you're kind of ready to address some of these things, you have to be talking to your kids. Mm-hmm. One of the biggest things that's gone by the wayside that indicates long-term mental health are family rituals. And one of the biggest rituals that we haven't had, interestingly, it's one of the biggest rituals that has come back during the lockdown for some families, but it's family meals.
Yes.
That we are living in an age prior to the lockdown where, you know, Johnny's at soccer practice and Susie's at dance practice and nobody's eating together. And so for the families that are thriving are the families that are sitting together, having meals together and talking. Not having the parents talk at their children, but listen and ask the right questions. The behaviors that I think are really important to look for are children that are beginning to isolate. And we're seeing a lot of this through the lockdown. And parents are up to here because the kids are trying to do school online, or parents are trying to homeschool and they're working from home and people are losing jobs. And so people are so stressed that I think sometimes the parents are just like, okay, just go to your room. I don't care that you've been in your room for, you know, 14 days straight, because they're up to here. So that's why parents have to take care of themselves first, but recognizing when there's a lot of isolation, something's going on. When the child doesn't want to talk about what's going on and gets real angry about it, that's often a sign as well. When you kind of want to push and talk, especially with teenagers, they hate talking to their parents. But it is trying to grab those moments, sitting at a table or when the child's going to bed, of putting down, you know, the computer, the phone, the tablets, all of this stuff. The stuff that's going on in this world for children right now, I'm just horrified. I hear stories every day of the things that are happening and I've got a young adult now as a child, but I would have never thought some of this stuff is going on. And so communicating with your kids, being aware and being open, and trying to not be that judgy parent that's going to be shaming and controlling and condemning. Listen. Be the parent that just is going to listen. You can freak out later, but listen.
Yeah.
Listen.
Yeah. Amen. Well, I can't agree with you anymore. I mean, you've got so much good stuff. I think your stuff is incredible. That's why we wanted to have you come out. I'm glad that you guys got a chance to hear from her. I hope you'll hang out for a little bit,
sure.
But I'm sure because people probably have some individual questions, they want to meet you and say hello. But one of the things, we're out of time, so one of the things that you said is so true. There's a lot of things happening with kids. We don't even realize how wicked it is. They're being indoctrinated in the public school system. They're being sexualized in the public school system to a massive degree that most parents aren't even close to being aware of. It's really disgusting. They're online. There are predators targeting our children. We've had people out talk to you about that. Next week, we've got Rudy Gonzalez with CERT Ministries is going to be out. This is a hardcore dude. He goes out and he does. I wish I could go with him like just for a week. Like he is a true legitimate pedophile hunter. This is what the guy does. You know, he goes and he gets the bad guys and saves the kids, then saves the young lady. So he's going to be out next week. Talk about CERT Ministries and what's going on. So you're not going to want to miss that. But again, we are out of time. So Dr. Shannae, thank you so much for coming out. It's a pleasure to see you again. Pleasure to have you out. And we hope we can have you out again.
Absolutely. Thank
you. All right. Lord bless you. All right, you guys. Thank you for coming out tonight. We will see you next week. God bless.